Every American is familiar with the tragic environmental disaster in Alaskan waters. And more than 10 million gallons of oil have been spilled with deadly results for wildlife and hardship for local citizens. We all share the sorrow and concern of Alaskans and the determination to mount a sustained cleanup effort.
On March 24, 1989, shortly after midnight, the oil tanker Exxon Valdez struck a reef and began spilling oil into Prince William Sound, Alaska. The tanker was carrying the equivalent of more than 1.2 million barrels of crude oil and spilled more than 11 million gallons, or 257,000 barrels worth of oil. The amount spilled was roughly the equivalent to 17 Olympic-sized swimming pools.
I bet you remember what you were doing that day, 1989, March 24th, this day, 1989, 26 years ago. Wow, it feels like just yesterday. It really does. Today on the program, then mayor of Homer, John Calhoun. What happened when he got the call from Senator Ted Stevens? What in the ensuing days that would follow? What happened? What was it like to be mayor of a small town hit by this news and the oil that would follow? Mark Fish is a friend of mine and a friend of the program, often a Senate candidate on the Libertarian ticket. You'll know him and remember him from this program and other appearances around the state. He was one of the first responders and, in fact, was in a Black Hawk helicopter over the site within hours. He'll be here to share his commentary. And you're welcome to weigh in. And I'd encourage it, would appreciate it, would enjoy it. If you take a minute and text me, where were you? What were you doing? What were you thinking? How did it impact your life that day in 1989, the Exxon Valdez oil spill? Did it? Were you here? Maybe you were like Dax, who replied on Facebook and was down in Los Angeles. Thought, well, that'll never affect me. And here he is living in Homer, Alaska. What about you? Where were you? What were you doing? What were you thinking about? Text me, won't you? Share your thoughts. 299-7653. 299-7653. And we'll just share. I mean, it's an interesting thing. I mean, put it in perspective. So you heard that 11 million gallons, equivalent of 100 million gallons was on board, 11 million spilled. Well, in 2010, I was thinking about it. I was thinking, well, how does, you know that the BP, the Deep Horizon was way worse. You just know that it was way worse by volume. Well, in the BP oil spill in 2010, more than 200 million gallons of crude was pumped into the Gulf of Mexico. For more than 87 days. Remember that? It just felt like it was never going to end. We could put a man on the moon. We could put a rocket on an asteroid. And we can't stop this spill. Incredible. After 20 years following the Exxon Valdez, 20 years following, don't have the technology to stop and cap that. Two different circumstances, I know, but wow. 16,000 miles of coastline have been affected by the Deep Horizon 2010 BP spill. Louisiana, Texas, Mississippi, Alabama, Florida. Wow. Initial oil rig explosion killed 11 people, injured 17 more. 5.5 million feet of boom, a barrier placed in the water to collect the oil. Wow, just incredible. Incredible. This day in history also, Harry Houdini was born in 1874. Coincidence, I don't think so. Hungarian-born magician and escape artist. 1874. Happy birthday, Harry. Boy, we've come a long way, baby. 1883 on this day, March 24th, 1883, long-distance telephone service took a huge leap. The inaugural call between Chicago and New York City. 1883, the first long-distance phone call. I remember my first cell phone call. I'll never forget this. And you have these moments in your life where you really can't explain why you remember it or why the behavior was such. For example, my mom and dad had a cell phone. Tiffany and I were outside of, we were living in Anchorage at the time. This was 1992. And we're living in Anchorage. We met them for dinner at Red Robin on Diamond. And we're standing in the parking lot. And I said something about, well, let's go over there, but we'd have to call. Dad pulled out his cell phone, handed it to me. It was a Mactel flip phone, about the size of a, I don't know, not quite a brick, but it was a big phone. And I grabbed the phone. And I flipped open the little deal, exposed the pad, and I literally, as I'm dialing, I, not even thinking, subconsciously, unconsciously, lowered myself between the Suburban and my car, his Suburban and my car, and lowered myself down. I don't even know. They're like, what are you doing? Why are you hiding? I don't know. This is new. It was weird. Oh, man. That was in 1992. Well, prior to that, in 1883, the first telephone call between Chicago and New York took place. Elvis Presley, on this day in 1958, was inducted into the Army in Memphis, Tennessee. That's right. Elvis Presley served in. Boy, wouldn't you want to serve with him? You had to know, right, that nothing was going to happen to you. It's like, I want to serve with him. He was going to be kept as far from danger as possible. And on this day in history, The Dark Side of the Moon, Pink Floyd, that's right, they released in 1973 The Dark Side of the Moon, one of their, if not the, best Pink Floyd albums, I think. The song Money, The Dark Side of the Moon. It was a great, great album. In fact, my folks owned the car wash, and I was working at the car wash at the time here in Homer on Pioneer Avenue, and somebody left a massive box, probably cleaning their car out on their way out of town, left a massive box of albums, of, you know, LP albums. In it were the Allman Brothers, Doobie Brothers, Pink Floyd, all of Mitch Ryder and the Detroit Wheels, all a really eclectic group of rock and roll. And we waited for, oh, gosh, weeks. That box sat there for weeks, maybe even a month or two. And finally, he's like, well, nobody's coming back for him. Let's divvy him up. And I took home The Dark Side of the Moon. And I used that in mixtapes with my now wife, Tiffany, my beautiful girlfriend at the time. Now my wife, some 26 years, 27 years later. Anyway, yeah, that appeared on the mixed tapes from then on. Hey, Christy Weber's going to be on the program after 1 o'clock. Christy Weber's a realtor in Soldotna. More importantly, and why she's on the program today, she's a contestant for Mrs. Alaska. Forget not that just a couple years ago, Homer's own Vicki Sarber went on from winning Mrs. Alaska all the way to Hollywood with Mrs. America. Christy Weber's in the studios after 1 o'clock. We're going to be talking about her bid for Mrs. Alaska. Silas Firth to follow that. Silas came in fourth or fifth, I forget which, in the World Ice Carving Championships, which took place in Fairbanks recently. He was up against all manner of competition from around the world. He and his sister Aurora did very, very well. Silas will be here to discuss that. We might even touch on his movie-making career, which is forthcoming. I'm Chris Story, along with David Webb. You're listening to what my mom calls the greatest show on earth. Don't go anywhere. Much more to come here on Alaska Matters Radio. I'm Chris Story, your host for Great Adventures in the Last Frontier. We're memorializing and talking about the Exxon Valdez mobile, well, I guess it wasn't mobile then, oil spill. The Exxon Valdez oil spill in 1989 happened on this day in 1989. In just a moment, John Calhoun, then mayor of Homer, Alaska, will join us. We'll talk about his remembrances and his experience. I'm inviting you to join in the conversation by texting me your thoughts and your remembrances and what you were doing. Where were you? I bet you never forget. Text me at 299-7653. 299-7653. We'll share before the end of the program. Brought to you by today, Alaska Mindbender. Brought to you by Blackwater Bend Espresso. Not your average drip. Now, I'm pretty excited about this because together, Pat and I have come up with a new drink. Now, Bulletproof Coffee has been out there for a couple of years. Maybe you've tried it. It's a combination of either coconut oil and coffee or butter and coconut oil and coffee. And, well, rumor has it that it gives you a lot of energy, speeds up the metabolism, hyperactivates the brain, and all kinds of great stuff, and might even be leading to some weight loss. So I don't know about any of that. But I wanted to try it for myself, so I did. I took some of my Blackwater Bend beans, ground them up, brewed a pot of coffee, took an immersion blender and a tablespoon of coconut oil at home, and I mixed myself up some Bulletproof Coffee. I'm telling you what, it's on fire. It is like cracking a cup, and it's legal, and it's awesome. You've got to try it. Pat and I came up with what we're calling the Blackwater Bullet today. Available at Blackwater Bend Espresso. It's 8 ounces of energy, my friend. You must try it. Go to Blackwater Bend Espresso. Get your normal drink too, whatever. Get your drink on any way you want. But please do yourself a favor and try the Blackwater Bullet. Do it. Blackwater Bend Espresso. Here's how you can go for free. The question of the day. What was Captain Joe Hazelwood's punishment for crashing the Exxon Valdez on Bly Reef? What was Joe Hazelwood's punishment? I'll give you three choices. A, he was fined $50,000 and 1,000 hours community service. B, $100,000 fine and 6 months jail time. Or C, $250,000 and 10,000 hours of community service. Text me your name and answer right now, 299-7653, 299-7653. I'll give you another way to join in, and that would be to email me at alaskamattersradio@gmail.com, alaskamattersradio@gmail.com. John Calhoun, then mayor of Homer, Alaska. So I guess I'll open this by saying hello, Your Honor, and welcome to the program.
Hi, Chris. Glad to be here.
John, what kind of wood do you not want on a boat?
Gee, I can think of a horrible answer, but I won't.
It's hazelwood. You want any wood but a hazelwood, a mahogany, teak, alder, oak, anything but hazelwood.
Yeah, that was one of the horrible answers. I wouldn't lower myself to that.
I wouldn't expect you to, my friend. I wouldn't expect you to. So I remember what I was doing, John. I was working on the fuel dock for Jake Ellison at the time, the only fuel dock in the Homer Harbor at that time, and in 1989. That was quite an experience to just live through that, watch the news. I mean, this was making news around the world. You, though, were mayor of this little cosmic hamlet by the sea. How did you hear about it? What was your first awareness of this event?
Well, you know, we get the daily news, and so you'd see there was an oil spill, Exxon Valdez, and there's disasters every day, so it just didn't really hit home how bad it was. But then every day it kept showing up in the paper, and they'd have a little map showing you how much it was spreading. And one day I got a call, it was a Saturday, to meet with Senator Stevens and somebody from the Coast Guard and some other agencies, and they wanted to discuss the oil spill, and I was still somewhat puzzled. And when they said it was actually, they were sure it was going to spread this far, it was just amazing. That is a long ways, and then it starts to sink in, the magnitude of the spill. That was my first real clue that, I mean, that, you know, we were going to be immersed in this thing.
Yeah, I mean, you were aware of it like everyone else. You were watching and reading the news, but then that really hit home. And so when you met with the, was it a Coast Guard admiral?
Yes.
And Senator Stevens, what was that meeting about?
I think it was.
Okay. Well, what was that meeting about, and what took place from there?
Well, basically told us what preparations, you know, they were going to make and what they were going to do in a very broad sense, and that Exxon would be coming, sending representation to Homer. And they set up also a multi-agency task force over in Seward, because that was going to get hit first. And, of course, in the worst part of the spill, of course, at that point was in the Sound. And from there, they ultimately had the same kind of a task force over here in Homer. But the first real resonance of, you know, something just actually happening here was when Exxon showed up, and they had a public meeting at the Homer High School in the auditorium, and that was long. And they had sent three people, and then they had representatives from like DEC and Fish and Game and whatever were all present, Coast Guard, and just everybody did a little bit of presentation, then a long session of questions and answers. And that was the beginning of it. Exxon set up headquarters here. The other agencies set up their own offices and stuff here, and we were off and running with a full-blown oil spill issue.
Now, you're a politician. You're the mayor. You took a very from what I know, and now that I've known you for about, coming up on 14 years here, I know you to be a real genuine human being, a good person, no matter what capacity you're in. So talk to us as a human being from that moment and the vantage point of being the mayor and responsible for a lot of people and or contact point. And what were you going through as just the human being, the man that would go home at night? What was this like for you?
It was hard. It really and truly was. And it was because of the conflict in the community. Everybody wanted something done about it. Some people wanted to do personally. Hey, we can build boom. We can do this. We can do that. It was, just a continuous stream of people wanting to do something and a continuous stream of people wanting Exxon to do something, wrestling with Exxon, who was not, totally forthcoming with by any way, shape or fashion. Mainly because there was nothing they could really do. This thing was bigger than anybody, and all they could do was just keep trying to put people off and throw money at it. Mm-hmm. And, the part of it I think that was pretty painful in the community, too, was there was an awful lot of greed involved. And I saw some really good people just seeing what they could make off of it legally or otherwise. And so those things were that just conflict went on and on, and you're as a mayor, civic leader, you want to fix it, and you can't. And I remember seeing, not too far into it, one of the guys who had been involved from the onset just broke down in tears one night. I mean, he was just overwhelmed just with everything going on, and he was drained, and I was surprised at that. And 3 weeks later, that was me. Going through the same thing. It was a tremendous, tremendous stressful event because there was just nothing you could really do to fix it.
John Calhoun, mayor of Homer, Alaska, 1989 during the oil spill. Thank you, John. I appreciate you sharing your thoughts today.
Okay. Can I take another minute, Chris?
Yeah, you bet. Half a minute. Go.
Okay. Just 1 second. And that's to say, here we had almost 25 years later, we had the oil spill in Mexico, and it was the same. We still are not prepared to handle it. And, it really behooves the government, the oil companies, somebody, we're going to pay for it as consumers, one way or another, to really look at this and say, what should we be doing to handle these situations? Because they're going to happen.
Yeah, you're right. It's inevitable, and that's a great way to look at it. Whether you pay at the pump or you pay in your tax bill, it's inevitable that the people, you and I, will pay for it. But it's, like you say, watching the Endeavor in the Gulf of Mexico for 87 days belch oil into the ocean is just phenomenal. To think that happened that many years after this tragedy that we're talking about, it's just unbelievable, really.
I think that's the biggest lesson I got out of it. We didn't learn anything.
There you go. All right. That's new math for you. Well, thanks, John. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Chris.
All right. Don't you go anywhere. We've got Mark Fish coming up and more Alaskan Mindbender here on Alaska Matters Radio. Listening to Alaska Matters Radio, I'm Christopher Story, along with David Webb. We're talking about the Exxon Valdez spill. Oh, man, something else. It's really something else. I know John Calhoun, and I know when he was mayor, it really did touch him. And I'm telling you, it just was is an event never to forget. Now, Joseph Hazelwood was a real person, is a real man. Let's dive into his psyche and his person, who he was, where he came from. We'll do that in just a little bit. Joining me in a moment is Mark Fish. Mark was on the scene hours after it happened. First, I want to ask you a question. when I ask you the Alaskan Mindbender question, brought to you by Blackwater Bend Espresso, not your average drip. Now, please do yourself. Don't do it for me. I get nothing out of this. Do it for you. Go to Blackwater Bend Espresso and order the Blackwater Bullet. Do it. It's bulletproof coffee. I'm telling you what, the Blackwater Bullet will make your day. It's 8 ounces of energy. If you don't like it, come and see me and I'll tell you why you do like it. Blackwater Bend Espresso. Here's the question, and you could go for free. What was Captain Joe Hazelwood's punishment for crashing the Exxon Valdez on the Bligh Reef? What was the punishment? $50,000 fine with 1,000 hours of community service, $100,000 and a 6-month jail sentence, or $250,000 fine with 10,000 hours community service? Text me right now your name and answer, 299-7653. And also, people are weighing in with their remembrances of where they were the day they heard about the Exxon Valdez. Mark Fish, where were you when you got the call that the Valdez had run aground?
Well, I was at my home, and I got a call. And frankly, I didn't even know what it was about. They just told me that I was a part-time National Guard soldier at the time, Blackhawk crew chief. And I got a call that told me to get my aircraft ready. There's an emergency in Valdez, and we need you here within the hour.
Wow.
So I didn't receive notice that it actually hit the reef until I was halfway to Valdez in the Blackhawk when we were called and given more information and told that our orders will catch up to us.
Wow. You know what, Mark? First of all, welcome to the program. Great to have you back. And you'll recall meeting Mark in previous episodes of Alaska Matters Radio when he was running for Senate on the Libertarian ticket. And we've also talked about Agenda 21 and a whole lot of stuff with Mark. And he's a friend of the show, and I'm proud to say a friend of mine. Mark, that tells me a lot about the National Guard and the commitment to the people that we have serving us. You didn't even know where you're. Talk about thrown to the lion's den like a chunk of meat. There you are, an hour into the trip, and you find out what's going on. When you first got on scene, tell us, describe through your eyes, what did you see?
Well, you know, it was a beautiful morning with weather just like today. It was sunshine, calm, everything was flat, and it was, you'd seen an obvious sheen coming from the tanker itself. It really struck us as we were there on the scene. We haven't had any missions yet, so we investigated it, and I think we were probably the first government aircraft out on the scene looking at it. And what really struck me is, why don't they just set it alight and torch it and burn this fuel off and save the drainage? Because it was a seep. It wasn't an outright gash. It was a slow leak. I think only 20% of what the tanker held actually leaked into the Sound.
Right. That's exactly right.
And in fact, the Coast Guard commander was later quoted as saying the only good thing that came out of it was the fact that we were able to get so much of the oil off the tanker and not into the Sound.
Mm-hmm.
And I was happy to be part of that effort. I actually got to land. Our aircraft landed on the tanker as we unloaded supplies, and we slung load a lot of transfer pumps out, which they kept getting up at the rate that they were using them. So we were kept busy.
As you look back on this event, Mark Fish, from 1989, what do you think happened that went really well, aside from the National Guard being called out and your guys' rapid response? What went well? What didn't go at all? And what did you take away from it all?
Well, what went well is the commitment to the person on the ground. You know, every Alaskan that I met that had something to do with that. We had people walking up and saying, "What can I do?" And not expecting anything out of it, just wanting to pitch in. And I think that's the best thing that happened is Alaskans really stepped up when they seen something wrong. And didn't wait for somebody else to, you know, to tell them. They were all in as soon as they heard. What went wrong was, well, there's plenty. You know, we didn't have any kind of organized emergency service response to it. The airspace in Valdez was unrestricted at the time. And we had a real problem with the press helicopters and the traffic that ensued in the next week. There's only one inch nozzle of JP4 in Valdez, and the aircraft were stacked up with no order on who gets priority for this. So it really hampered efforts.
Wow, I did not realize that. When you say JP4, you're talking about jet fuel.
Right, which all the private contractors that were flying reporters out to photograph the scenes.
Wow.
They were swarming the aircraft. Their aircraft were swarming the tanker like bees when there was no controls and unrestricted the first several days. In fact, I've seen one reporter hanging from his knees of a Jet Ranger off the skids. Of a Jet Ranger circling the Exxon Valdez to get the best shot.
Oh, my Lord.
And that's actually the stock footage that you see is what he shot. And
wow.
I couldn't believe the lengths that some of these guys were going.
Unbelievable. Yeah, and so, well, what's the takeaway? I mean, obviously there's, we never want a tragedy like that to happen again. You noted that Alaskans are can-do and roll-up-the-sleeve kind of folk and get involved right on the ground. But what's the overall takeaway?
Well, I think we've gotten, because of it, I think we've gotten a lot better at responding to disasters. One of the things that we have now that we didn't have then is a method in place to ensure that the agencies have a way of paying for the responses to these unannounced disasters.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we've got better at that. Back then, nobody had a clue. In fact, I remember a lunch there where every agency that had a stake in helping was in there arguing and yelling at each other, trying to figure out what's going on. And the Coast Guard commander finally standing on top of the table and yelling, "Nobody getting moves until I figure out who's paying." so now we have that figured out. There's that. And I think the responses in the future would be more fluid because of it.
Wow. Mark Fish, thank you so much. Your hands-on, eyes-on, and your involvement in this, it's been an interesting way to look at the whole event. So thank you so much for being here today.
You're welcome. And all I can say is I was happy to be a part of it. It's one of the highlights of my life.
Wow. Well, thanks for sharing it with us today. And I've got to get you back on another time and find out what's next, politically speaking, for Mark Fish. Will you come back?
Sure. Anytime, Chris.
All right. Thank you so much, Mark. I appreciate it. Yeah, what an event. Again, this is, you've heard from John Calhoun. You've heard from Mark Fish, and I want to hear from you. People are texting in. The number is 299-7653, 299-7653. Angie says, "I was in eighth grade English class at Palmer Junior High when she heard about the Exxon Valdez." Isn't that interesting? When the Challenger... Space Shuttle Challenger exploded, I was in an eighth grade English class as well. Isn't that interesting? You remember where you were when these kinds of things happened. Wow. Let's see here. Yeah, a lot of responses. Look, keep them coming. We'll share them. Philip says he was 10 years old at the time of the Exxon Valdez. I'm not sure how it affected me. It's a horrible disaster that we're still learning from today. That's true, Philip. Text me on 299-7653. Now join me on the Alaskan Mindbender. Question, what was Hazelwood's punishment? $50,000, $100,000, or $250,000 fine? 299-7653, alaskamattersradio@gmail.com. Christy Weber's in the queue, running for Mrs. Alaska. Following that, world ice carving champion Silas Firth is going to join me here on what my mom calls the greatest show on earth. I'm Chris Story, along with David Webb, who's producing the program back up at the mothership of KPEN FM 102. Don't go anywhere. Alaska matters, and so do you. From on top of the world, I'm Chris Story. Dan Danner recently wrote an article called "Don't Back Down." Dan says, "Sometimes it feels like your government is dedicated to making your life more difficult, and sometimes it's more than a feeling. It's the truth." Danner goes on to say, business owners are community leaders. You encourage your community, and to future generations, your leadership and understanding of what works for our economy just might make you a hero. Yes, you are a leader in your community, and if you stand up and speak up and speak truth to power, you are a hero. Look at that rocker from the group Stain. He stopped his show to point out a young girl being groped. He's being touted as though he did something noble. Well, I guess he did. He spoke up. Speak up today and secure tomorrow. And just because they call you paranoid doesn't mean they're not out to get you. On Top of the World, I'm Chris Story. Oh, man, what a great program. What a great program. I want to thank John Calhoun. I want to thank Mark Fish, Silas Firth, whom you just heard from, and Christy Weber. Just making a terrific program. And I want to thank you. A lot of you have entered to win this contest, so let's get down to it. The question, what was Captain Joe Hazelwood's punishment for crashing the Exxon Valdez on Bly Reef that fateful day? This day, March 24th, 1989, $50,000 fine and 1,000 hours community service. I want to congratulate Melanie and Randy both. Yes, Randy, you did win. That was his question to me. Yes, Melanie and Randy both going to Blackwater Bend Espresso for free. Thank you. Knew that Captain Joe Hazelwood received 1,000 hours community service. And I'll never forget seeing a video. You probably saw it too. I think it was on KTUU, or I forget which station covered it most heavily, but he was serving food at Beans Cafe. Serving food at Beans Cafe, Captain Joseph Hazelwood. So I guess there was some humiliation involved there, but let's talk about Captain Joseph Jeffrey Hazelwood, born September 24th, 1946. He's noted as an American sailor. Was a captain, of course, of the Exxon Valdez during its 1989 oil spill. He was accused of being intoxicated, which contributed to the disaster, but was cleared of this charge at his 1990 trial after witnesses testified that he was sober around the time of the accident. Hazelwood was convicted of a lesser charge, negligent discharge of oil, which is a misdemeanor, fined $50,000, and sentenced, of course, as we've just learned, to 1,000 hours community service. He was born in Hawkinsville, Georgia, raised in Huntington, New York, on the north shore of Long Island. His father, Joseph, born 1922, was a United States Marine Corps torpedo bomber pilot turned airline pilot after the war. His mother, Margaret, was born in 1920 in Georgia. Hazelwood was then their first son. He was married in 1969 to Suzanne, and they have one daughter together, Allison, who was born September 7, 1975. In 1964, Hazelwood graduated from Huntington High School, where his IQ was tested at 138. As a youth, he was an avid sailor and a member of the Sea Scouts. In 1968, he received a Bachelor's of Science degree in Marine Transportation from the State University of New York Maritime College. Following his graduation in college in 1968, he was hired on as a third mate on the Humble Oil and Refining Company, which later became Exxon Shipping Company. His first ship was S.O. Florence, homeported in Wilmington, North Carolina. Hazelwood climbed the ranks of the Merchant Marine until he obtained his master's license, age 31. By age 32, he was the youngest captain working for the Exxon Corporation, and he commanded the Exxon Philadelphia, a California to Alaska tanker, in 1978. In 1985, he was a master of the Exxon Chester when the asphalt carrier ran into a storm during its New York to South Carolina trip. High winds damaged the ship's mast, including radar and radio communication antennas. Though the crew was prepared to abandon ship, Hazelwood rallied them and guided the ship to safety. In 1987, he became the alternate master of the Exxon Valdez, which subsequently received Exxon Fleet Safety Awards for the years 1987 and 88. Here's where it gets a little darker. Hazelwood's driver's license had been suspended or revoked three times by the state of New York for alcohol violations since 1984. At the time of the Exxon Valdez incident, his New York State driving privileges, this is just mind-boggling, were suspended as a result of driving under the influence. And yet, he could captain a tanker in 1988. That was September 1988. He entered a rehabilitation program in 85 in Amityville, New York. Following rehabilitation, 90 days of leave to attend Alcoholics Anonymous. But it was not clear if he attended during the leave. This is also interesting. Hazelwood never had his master's license revoked, and it remains valid to this date. But he's been unable to find long-term work as a captain after the spill. Duh. His alma mater, Sunny Maritime California College, hired him. Excuse me, not California, New York. Show of solidarity as a teacher aboard the TS Empire State. Interesting. Huh. Well, the reason I wanted to share that was he's a human being. He's a real human being. Made a mistake. But he's a real human being. And I learned a lot in researching for this program. I did not know about Captain Joseph Hazelwood. What I knew was that he's a drunk, ran aground, Bly Reef. I mean, that was a terrible incident. Terrible guy. But, you know, human being nonetheless. And I imagine he's paid in more ways than you and I will ever truly understand. Coming up on Thursday, got a great program for you. We'll do our TBC Word of the Week, TBC Radio Word of the Week on Thursday. Got a lot of good stuff planned for Thursday Radio Realty program. I hope you join me. Hope you join me 24/7 online on topoftheworldradio.com. On topoftheworldradio.com. And by the way, this some of you will know this. Happy birthday, Rufus. That's right. Rufus King was an American lawyer, politician, and diplomat. He was a delegate for the Massachusetts, for the Continental Congress. Why am I telling you this? Well, he was born today. It's his birthday. And it will come into play on Radio Realty on Thursday. That's right. Radio Realty Thursday. Remember that. Rufus King. See, tying the two together because I want you to join me and I want you to have a leg up on the competition. Maybe you'll have a free dinner out of the deal. Thank you, David Webb, for engineering and producing this great program. Again, thank you to my wonderful guests. Thank to all the great sponsors, Napa Auto Parts of Homer, Anchor River Inn, Anchor Point Natural Foods, and you for listening to what my mom calls the greatest show on earth. I'm Chris Story, reminding you Alaska matters, and so do you.
Only light we'll see.